We represent a community when we do this. And these people aren't characters or caricatures. This happened to real people. People have PTSD from this. People are still dealing with the grave effects of the crack epidemic.
So looking back at the last episode, Jerome went through like such a whirlwind after the shooting, especially at the hospital. How did you approach those scenes as an actor?
Wow. You know, when you work with someone for what now, I've been working with Angela Lewis for about 5 years now. So what's beautiful about that is that when you first approach, you know, working with an actor, you're using a lot of things from your own personal life. You're using a lot of imagination, you know. But after working with for 5 years with Angela Lewis, the spirit that she is, the woman that she is, I really feel like she is one of the most gracious scene partners that I've ever worked with. So I could use a lot of what really means something to me about her personally. And if you could think about losing someone like that, you know, it brings a lot of emotion about it. It brings a realism, you know. Mm-hmm. So it was kind of a surreal scene because putting her there and you know, the love that I have for her as a fellow actor and as a sister, I was able to use a lot of that, and along with, you know, the script and the heightened circumstances that we're in, mm-hmm. you know, that's what played into it.
And what do you think about Jerome's insistence on getting revenge? Do you feel like that's a smart idea, or maybe not so much?
Personally, I feel like cooler heads usually are best to prevail, but I can understand that. I think there's a few things that hit the primal level in any man or woman when it comes to their family, when it comes to the things that is most important to them. And although I would like to think, sitting on the outside, that I may not respond like that, I do know that, you know, that kind of, it's like your croc brain, you know what I mean? It's like your nature to want to seek revenge or to avenge what has happened to your loved one. So from the outside, I'll probably say that I won't give judgment on it, but I would hope to have a cooler head.
And looking at Jerome's relationship and kind of how it's been affected by him being in the drug game, him having to deal with the CIA, how do you think, and I know you probably can't say too much, but how do you think he moves forward from something so traumatic?
I mean, I think it's okay to say that, you know, that things are coming to a head. He was left in the dark as a character. And I think that Jerome is a loyalist, but I feel like until the family is set square, as long as this family is feuding, and as long as Jerome feels that he's on the outside of the decision-making, I feel like the family will continue to feud. And with things so frayed in the world as it is, you know, in their world, that's not going to be a good thing.
And you mentioned in a past interview that you remembered seeing crack vials around your neighborhood growing up, and witnessing yeah. those different things that were part of the crack epidemic. How do you think that experience affected your work on Snowfall?
It brings another layer of, like I said, of reality. You know, at the end of the day, I am not this character. I don't like to call these portrayals characters. They're a little bit more personal to me than that. Mm-hmm. So, you know, yes, the growing up and seeing some of growing up and seeing crack vials, growing up and knowing people that were addicted to this awful drug, mm-hmm. knowing people that sold it, knowing people that were incarcerated by it. Looking at my school zone and seeing how different monies were put in, different social programs were implemented to offset or to even incarcerate, you know, draconian laws used to put people away. All of those things have affected me personally in my neighborhood. And so to me, in a way, Snowfall is a reminder. It's a reminder, a stark reminder of the past. And we're still dealing with the residual of a lot of these things today. Mm-hmm. You know, we're dealing with, this is still something that's going on, you know, easily 20, 30 years removed.
Yeah, and you know, sadly, this was your first season filming without John Singleton. What was that like for you personally to return to set?
It's a heartbreak. We lost John in about episode 7 of season 3. And we haven't had him since. And then we also went through, you know, this pandemic. So it was an added pressure. I think it's a circle of truth around our head to get it right, to continue to keep the content unapologetic, speak, you know, truth to power for each artist and each person behind the camera. We have an amazing crew, we have an amazing staff of writers, and we're supported by our network and our studio to make the best art that we can out of this and tell this harrowing tale, hopefully not too sensationalized, but realize this is something that happened to actual people. We represent a community when we do this. And these people aren't characters or caricatures. This happened to real people. People have PTSD from this. People are still dealing with the grave effects of the crack epidemic. So knowing all of that and knowing that we have a big brother, like an ancestor looking over us, that has showed us a blueprint toward getting this story done. You know, we're still ecstatic about that, but there's a circle of truth of getting it right.
And it seems like Snowfall, you know, really found its way during the pandemic. So many people were binge watching on Hulu and it's really kind of blown up. What has it been like for you to be a part of this cast and be a part of this moment?
It's always great to have people tune in to what you're doing, and hopefully you're doing some good work. Hopefully you're doing something worth tuning into, you know? We're happy that Snowfall has finally found an audience outside of our niche audience, but we did have, you know, we had some amazing fans that have been with us since season 1. And I think, you know, opening up this to the platform Hulu gave us a little bit more access. I think you're right about the pandemic and that people perhaps had a little bit more time to binge something that they, you know, sometimes you're in the third season of something, even the second season of something, it's like, whoa, I don't really have time in my busy schedule to go back. I think the pandemic in a way afforded some of our new fans the luxury of binging. And we're feeling the residual of that, you know, which we love. We would love, you know, even more people to see this because we think it's more than just entertainment.
Mm-hmm. And I have to say, I was one of those fans from season 1. It's like such quality work. Love it.
You know, I call out the fans on social media sometimes. I'd be like, really? Were you really there day one with Snowfall?
Shooting in the gym. Really? Were you there shooting in the gym?
Were you there when I was shooting in the gym? Exactly.
And then just to close out, we have to ask you, what can you tell us about the upcoming episode on Wednesday, episode 9? Is there anything you can let us know?
Of course, I can let you know that you're going to be, you know, holding on by the, you know, you're going to be white knuckled holding on to your seats. This particular episode is one of my favorites. Usually episode 9 of each season for me is, you know, because we're almost at that season finale, and the season finale usually has so much anticipation on it that the one before it is usually a setup and a finale of its own. You know, so a lot of things are going to come to head. Violence will ensue. This will be, you know, this will be a really phenomenal episode, and you know, there's no turning back from some of the decisions that the characters make and the way that the world is unfolding out.